I'm glad to have here our special guest, so Mr. Riccardo Pozzoli, CEO and co-founder of the Blonde Salad and Terrarani Collection, Mauro Benedetto from Fresh Time, and Teresa Emanuela Prandelli. So thanks for coming from Bocconi Series for Fashion.
Buongiorno a tutti ragazzi, io sono Pozzoli, sono rappresentante in collegio docenti e oggi rappresento Pilar, ci tenevo a ringraziare per questa bellissima partecipazione di stasera. La conferenza stasera sarà in inglese, perché è veramente sul tema del fashion e del digital e avremo già presentato Pozzoli e gli ottimi ospiti, Riccardo Pozzoli, Mauro e Benedetto, e ringraziamo veramente la professoressa Prandelli. Ci tenevo a ringraziare fortemente i ragazzi di Bocconi Students for Fashion, Sofia, Luca, tutti i ragazzi di Pilato che hanno collaborato, i ragazzi del servizio d'ordine e il nostro responsabile eventi, Giovanni Vano. Grazie ancora per la partecipazione e buon proseguimento.
Because of the two speakers that we are able to host and to have a conversation with this night. So I'm very proud to introduce the kind of very, I would say, informal dialogue that we have delivered this night with Riccardo Pozzoli, that was already introduced, was, let me say, first of all, very proud. He was my thesis. So this is something that I'm very happy to say. And of course, we did a wonderful thesis with an experiment starting from the blog salad. So I hope that you have something to say also starting from that ancient or at this point experience. But I'm really happy then to ask Riccardo to tell us, starting from the topic of this night, the social business, how they could really transform the blonde salad that was originally just a blog into a lifestyle brand that today is much more than a blog. It's really a lifestyle magazine. It's a brand that is developing a huge number of cooperation with the most relevant brands in the fashion world. So I really love to know from Riccardo how you can move from a social blog, from a blog, to a business that is today as successful as we were doing. And then I would love to leave the floor to Mauro Benedetto, who is the founder together with four friends of Fresh Time, which is a pretty interesting startup that is relying on social networks, especially in Facebook and Instagram, in order to come up with a very specific analysis of customer preferences. And so in some way we can say that Mauro is doing business through the social network. So these are two different approaches to the opportunity to rely on a social network in order to create different kind of entrepreneurial avenue. And I think that we are very happy to have the chance to discuss with the founder of this business this wonderful experience together this night. So I'm very proud now to give the floor to Riccardo Pozzoli. Really, I think it doesn't need any kind of further presentation, and I think that he has so many things to share with us. Thank you.
The very first thing that we have to do and to say right now is to thank her Prandelli, because she was a bit fake when she was saying that she was so happy to have me in the dissertation in the beginning of the test, because I was not probably the best student ever. But like, I mean, she was running after me like every day, every week, because unfortunately I was really working, so I really, I was a mess. No, I'm not being in my. No, but I mean, really, Prandelli helped me a lot, also in understanding probably the value of what the Lone Salad was back in the time. Because we founded the Lone Salad in 2009, it was 12 October 2009. I was doing my internship program as an MM student here in Bocconi. I was doing my internship program in Chicago. And Chiara was studying here locally during Bocconi 2. And she was really passionate, really, really passionate about photography, about fashion. And as I was her boyfriend at the time, like, she was bothering me every single day. Please give me a picture, please give me a picture about that, please. Let's do this. Oh, look at my new sweater, you know, please, let's take a picture. Yeah, another picture. I mean, what the hell were we going to do with this picture, you know? And, but I mean, probably she was already seeing something. And so that's why in that year we decided to start this, you know, this adventure that was the Lone Salad. Chiara was already following a couple of fashion blogger, American fashion blogger, that basically were the very few examples of this kind of blogging that was you know, just basically was happening around the world. So obviously blogger didn't. The blogging phenomena was already existing since a long period, but the real innovation of the thing was putting your face. And so it was not telling people about something, but it was, you know, playing the role with the product, playing the role with the event, playing the role with the life, and sharing with your audience. So, in 2009, in the period in autumn, I was in Chicago. It was fucking freezing in Chicago, so I didn't have anything to do. And one day, you know, during the event, so I told her, you know what? I will try to understand what is exactly HTML, and I'll try to design a blog for you, and then, you know, just go and post your picture there, so at least we're not just taking picture for nothing. I mean, and at least we are, you know, collecting the picture of the content in a box, in something that you can, you know, build up and you can develop. So basically, it was just an hobby, just a, you know, free kind of spare time of thing. And that's why, that's how the Lone Salad was born. And the good thing is that usually they ask me, oh, but what was the investment for starting, you know, this project that today is a company, is a fashion company, working around the world, whatever. The investment was $10. We bought, like, you know, www.lonesalad.com GoDaddy, and it was, you know, like a former provider of domains, and that's it. Because it was just like a huge, huge amount of work. So, you know, finding the garments, and, you know, finding, you know, the cloth, whatever, and Tara was really, like, really passionate about that, so she was not investing in that. She was just trying, you know, to mix and match, to, you know, work with her man bags and maybe a t-shirt or something. But what really was the big job of that period was finding every day a new situation, like every day a new story to tell, to you know, to take a picture of, to write about, and to share with the Lone Salad readers back in time. And around 1 month and a half after that we founded the Lone Salad, so it was like around December, Clara was in Chicago, like John me in Chicago for a few weeks just to study English, and probably it was just an excuse to, you know, stay together. And but she came to Chicago and we went to her secret store. And a girl stopped Clara and said, no way, you are Clara, you really, like, I'm putting your blog every day. I looked at Clara and said, what? Like, an American girl here in Chicago is putting our blog, and we're just, you know, posting since 30 days, something. I mean, that's absolutely insane. So we started really understanding that probably that could be something really good, like really key. So after that, we went back to, I mean, not because of that, not because I finished my internship, we went back to Italy, and I took digital marketing, with the Prof. Prandelli back in Bocconi, and after that I started thinking that that would be a good project to, you know, work on a thesis. And I went to the professor, and the professor told me, "Oh, you're the guy from the Blanc Salad. We already are checking the Blanc Salad here in Bocconi. We're already super passionate about that." I said, "What the hell is going on? I mean, everybody's checking the Blanc Salad. We don't even know what we are doing, probably, you know." So, I mean, really, the professor really made us understand also what we were probably working on. Like, we really weren't realizing what we were working on. So we started this beautiful TEDx project that was, I don't even remember how long, but probably. So,
let me say that most probably times I would say, "Ricardo, this weekend we are going to work on the next chapter." The answer was, "Prof, I don't know, you are right, but it's, you know, a limousine that it's waiting for us in London. How can I give up this kind of opportunity?" So, yes. I was not really near enough to say no.
No, it was a very interesting process and very fun to be in the time of the pandemic. No, in reality, really, like, it has been a wonderful process, and the thesis was about just giving a little bit more information about that. Like, the thesis was about basically trying to understand how this new tool, this new communication tool, could change the perception of luxury brand into the market. So basically, we did like an experiment. So basically, we showed you like two similar clusters. We showed like in both picture the Chanel bag, but in one picture the Chanel bag was inside, like was into a classic Chanel advertising campaign on Vogue page, I think, something like that. And the other cluster was shown the same Chanel bag, but worn by Clara with probably Zara or H&M outfit and something. And basically, we tried to evaluate what was the perception, the willingness to pay, you know, toward the product, and, you know, many other kind of KPIs that basically show us that we had like really good results. And we discovered that basically the users was changing the approach toward that brand because of the different kind of communication. So seeing the bag worn by Clara instead of a, you know, traditional campaign, basically was changing also the idea of the possible usage of that bag and the idea of that brand. So it was basically making the brand closer to the users instead of creating the gap. And probably that was the beginning of the revolution in consumption of fashion. So probably since that, not because of us, but in general because of, you know, the revolution that was going on, and basically the approach to luxury product, completely changed in that period. So it was completely changed, like the mix and match phenomena, and, you know, many other aspects of this revolution brought luxury to be what it is today, and very far from what was like 15 years ago. That basically was all built about the, like, you know, the admiration and the desirability of the brand. So that's it. But now I go a bit faster, no? So otherwise I will work it. But after that, we went back to Italy. We started working about this project, and in the beginning of 2010. The blogger phenomenon became really big and common in Europe. So big brands could, you know, started asking me how can we work together? Because the good thing was that it was completely an open field. Like we didn't have any kind of benchmark, because blogger phenomenon was completely new, and the luxury and fashion brand didn't know obviously anything about that. I still remember like a couple of phone calls from companies like, I don't know, Dior marketing manager that was calling me, "Oh, you're the guy from, you're the guy about blogs, can you come here to talk with me and just explain me exactly what a blog is?" So, okay, I mean, we will have a few things to talk about, but okay, we can do that. So, I mean, we were really starting from scratch. So we were really trying to understand what was going on and how the luxury world could, you know, work with this new communication tool. As I always say, that's the best way not to do mistakes, because there are no benchmarks, so no one can say that you are doing mistakes. So in reality, it was really challenging and was really interesting and I mean really inspiring, trying to understand these people and with this, you know, their experiences, their skills, how to work with them. So from that point, so in 2010, we started creating projects with the companies and we started trying to understand also their needs. Obviously, they didn't know exactly how to work with bloggers, and they didn't know what kind of contents and product, you know, create together. So that's why we started investing also in people in our team and helping us in producing contents, in managing the link with the brands, managing the PR, working with that, and creating projects that these kind of companies could understand and could invest on. So basically, we immediately decided to invest in a company that was helping us. And the luxury brand worked together and created something that was built together. In 2011, we invested a lot in the world, let's say, development. Because we realized that our tool, as we started from the beginning, you know, hosted in English, like blog didn't have any kind of geographical border. So immediately, like companies all over the world started asking us to travel, to live experience, to attend events, and to create contents all around the world with their product to give something more to their product, to their brands, to make all the communication around those kind of events, around those kind of experiences blog. And we invested a lot in that. I think that in 2010 we got like around 200 flights. But it also gave us like a huge, you know, like a huge experience all around the world, and let us understand exactly the, you know, the power and the magnitude of this huge revolution that was going on. Also during 2012, Instagram was basically becoming huge all over the world. And I think Instagram has been launched in 2010 or something. I don't know. 2010, right. But obviously in Europe became very, very huge in 2012. And I remember that I immediately jumped on Instagram as she understood that it was like a very interesting channel. And she put all of her efforts in producing content on that, because I mean it was so easy to make a picture post, just a caption, put a filter, and the picture was on. It was not like the same process of a blog, because blogging means take a picture with your graphics camera, go back, post it, write a text, post, and I mean, it's not like a half an hour job, it's like a few hours job. So she started using this tool that was so easy and so immediate. And also, it was even cutting again that short filter that posting on a blog had. So it was even more, you know, closer to the users. So Karen immediately got a huge response from her audience on Instagram, but the problem was arising. So the contents of the blog salad were not appealing anymore for our users, because Karen was basically spoiling every post on Instagram. So at that point, end of 2012, we had the visits on the blog salad that basically were going down and crazy. We were like one third of the visit that we had at the beginning of the year. And we were facing a choice at that point. So we were just you know, asking ourselves what we want to do with the ones. We want to go on and push on social media, and back in the time was only Instagram and Snapchat, was not even there. Or we want to keep the ones and try to develop this brand as a media brand. So probably 2012, I think that was one of the most important year of our short story, because we took, I think, the right decision to invest in that brand and create a media company around that brand. Because social media obviously is a huge phenomenon, it's a huge thing, but what we managed to build up the brand and the platform is giving us like 10 times the value as a company that we can do around just, you know, social media. So we decided to keep the ones that are alive. We decided to hire an editorial team, like the fashion editor from American.pt, a couple of other people with experience in editing content, like traditional, let's say, editorial. But we try to form them and we try to bring them to our lifestyle. And obviously, Chiara, like, as front, try really to give them her taste, her vision, her lifestyle about the contents. So we started like, in time to post 3 times a day, short content, not necessarily with picture short by us, but what we did was that basically to make our users get used to read this kind of content on the console. So basically they went back and after not even 7-8 months probably, so by the end of 2013, we went back exactly to the same level of visits and users that we had before the Instagram, the Instagram big penetration of the market. That was probably one of the most important decisions we took because deciding to build up a brand, a bigger brand, was probably we took that decision most people we were young. Because, it takes a lot of risk too, because you are facing basically the huge and big media brands that are around the world. When I talk about Kundanast, when I talk about Hearst, when you talk about those kind of giant publishing company, you don't even, a clever person and a rational person, probably we never think to do something, to get inside that kind of market. But in reality, those kind of brands are brands that probably, and maybe even unfortunately, they are not really anymore part of the next generation interest. So today, what we are really understanding from the market is that you, as you are way younger than me and probably, and the next generation, like Generation Z, after teenager, they are not recognizing the old media brand anymore. Even if both today is trying to do as much as they can and everything in their power to create content and to try to speak the young people language, I think that they will not meet so well. Because unfortunately, today, like an 18 years old guy today doesn't want to get close, to get linked to the same brands that their parents, that his parents were linked to. So this is part of the revolution. As there has been a huge revolution to consumption, into communication, now, like, younger generation, they want a new benchmark, new landmark in their inspiration, in their kind of lifestyle. So that's why it is a huge market and there's a huge opportunity for who wants to communicate something today, because there's an open field and the huge giants already present in this field are not scary anymore. Just to complete the evolution phase, after making the Lanzada and Lifestyle Magazine, I can say, we also decided past year to launch an e-commerce hub. Because my idea about the Lanzada is to create a media brand and a media company that is trying to engage, entertain, and give value in all the way possible to our users, to the long side fans. So that's why today we are organizing events to really engage these users in the reality. We are producing our contents because we want that our DNA is really vertical and deep inside our contents. We are creating travel guide, we are creating food guide, we are creating all that. We are trying to give our users our point of view in all the industries related to the lifestyle, related to their life. And also creating product, limited edition product, exclusively available on the website was the way to make them even in another way, part of the blog salad experience. And that's basically a way to make them, to make them to touch that with a non-salad style, non-salad brand, even in reality. So, I mean, I don't even know if maybe one day we will open a non-salad hotel or something to make them even deeper experience. But for sure, what I think today is that probably there are not any more food brands, hotelery brands, fashion brands, or automotive brands. Today, all the brands are lifestyle brands. We started from the media company, like the media industry. We will probably evolve into, you know, product industry. Maybe we will open the downside restaurant or whatever. But the idea is that in the future, people will recognize themselves into brands, just lifestyle brands. And now we are at a certain point where we have, I mean, few other possibilities to develop, few other possibilities to grow and go on. And these kind of few possibilities are probably the world, I can say. So, I mean, we just did a very short journey in reality, compared to what the possibilities and the opportunities are today for who wants to make a brand. So I think that for now it's enough, so I mean at least now we can talk too, and we'll go on. Thank you.
For the next chapters that to come. It's pretty exciting and just to dream about. Now I would like to give the stage to Paolo Vietto, who is the founder of the quite a different company because they're trying to rely on social networks to help other companies to make their own business. So if you want to just tell us a bit more about the company, the presentation, the chat presentation that you have developed, and then I'd like to address you a few more questions.
Okay, so first of all, thank you for taking the Bocconi Confession for the invitation. And coming after Riccardo, which is a giant in what he does, it's quite an honor and also a responsibility. But today I would like to try to explain what we do. Professor Prandelli knows the B2B part of what we do, which is actually what I explained and what I did in the last year going around Italy and sometimes also Europe to try to, you know, to involve brands to join our network. But today, I want to focus more on the C2C part, on the consumer part, which is basically the new mobile app we're launching, which we say is the first fashion lifestyle network for millennials. Before starting, before saying anything, I want to show you a very short video, which is a very emotional communication video. It's not a classic tutorial video, which is going to set the tone of the communication. It's going to let you know, let you understand how we, what's our target user base, and how we communicate with them.
Till the first time is the moment I show it. I just wanna live my life. Just wanna be myself all night. And I don't even care about the damn life. It's all about the time I spend it out. Show y'all what I wear. Show y'all what I do. Show y'all what they wear. Yeah, it's fucking right in the back. Spend your time on me. Yeah, keep them like a piece. This is really me, yeah. I want you to buy your best time. You don't stop those. You should download them right now. Big shout out to young Marco. Don't let no problem. Don't want to be catching. Cash time, get cash time. It's a monster. Whoop.
So, you have to be on. It's a fancy. Okay. What are we? We are the first fashion lifestyle network for millennials. Why millennials? Everyone talks about millennials right now. I want to just give you some information that I'm sure you already know, but you know, it's better to repeat sometimes. And 20% who millennials are and what are their characteristics. First of all, millennials, in my opinion, is the cause of the evolution of social media in the fashion luxury industry. That's because they're characteristic. Who are millennials? Okay, there are many definitions of who millennials are, and someone says millennials are people born from the 1980s to the 2000s, other people say from the 1980s to the 1996. Other people say that from the 1998 to the 1996 they're called millennials, and from the 1996 to the 2000 they're called post-millennial generation Z. Okay, I don't care. We say that millennials are people born by 1986 to 2000. At least that's our very sad. At least that's our target user base. That's people we talk to. But now that we know who millennials are, let's try to understand why everyone tries to target millennials. Okay, the first reason is a very banal numerical reason. They are the largest cohort worldwide. We're talking about 2 billion millennials worldwide, 11 billion just in Italy, and in the US, they will represent more than 75% of the workforce by 2025. So that's just for you to understand the size of the issue, the size of the millennial issue, I say. But also, millennials, for the first time, is the first generation that is able to influence other generations. Let me give you an example. The smartphone. Smartphone born and are distributed mainly for millennials. But especially in the last years, generation people in the generation X or the baby boomers, so I'm talking about people from previous generation, are purchasing more and more smartphones. If we extend that to another characteristic, which is that basically some researchers show that older generation, Generation X and the Uber, basically share the same habits of the one millennials by copying them. That means we can say this will the millennial influence our cohorts. And that's something that never happened in the past, and that's also very interesting for brands, because brands target millennials, they automatically target all the other generations. But it's not so easy. It's not so easy for two main reasons. The first reason is because millennials can spend less than previous generations. This is quite known. They are doesn't mean that they are poorer, just they can spend less because they born and raised during the financial crisis. Let me give you my example. I born in 1992, so I have someone, especially someone remind me for Pozzoli. Okay. So and I raised during 2008. My teenage was during 2008, 2011. So in the middle of the financial crisis, before the US and Europe. So our mindset, the mindset of millennials, especially the one born end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, is a mindset of people that grown up into a society in crisis. That means that they make more accurate decisions when they would have to purchase something. And then millennials communicate and simply are influenced by other channels. That's quite common, quite easy to explain. Millennials use smartphones. They just computer. Another example is simply the first and most important influence, let's say element of influencing the purchasing habit has always been friends. I buy something, my friends buy it. Let's remain on the first place. However, internet moved from the second position to the second position as the influencer characteristic. I buy something because I see that on internet. If you sum friends plus internet, you come out on social media. And that, of course, is quite a problem for brands that would have to communicate better with friends themselves than they do. But let's come out to that. Why is special for millennials? Okay, here we play a little game. We show some characteristics that we think millennials have in common, and we try to explain the features of this mobile app that is already in Apple Store as a, let's say, as a beta, to face these characteristics of the millennials. The first characteristic everyone knows that millennials have a short attention span, the famous 8 seconds of the goldfish. Okay, what that means in terms of brand and what is the issue? Basically, if millennials have a short attention span, that means that attention becomes a commodity. It's a scarce element. As that is scarce element in the economy, that means that it has an higher demand, another value, and then a higher cost. What that means that brands have to pay more to catch attention of people. Let me give you some number. The eCPM, the cost per impression, means how much money brands pay to get advertising online or even in normal social or in normal channels, moved from $1.50 in 1966 up to $20 in 2015. That means that just by impression, it's doubling the value. That means that brands have to face a very tight budget, have to face a very huge problem. If we consider that, we said, okay, this is a huge problem, we need to come up with something that helps people to brands, normal people, to really measure the interests of users, all of us, regarding some visual content, regarding one photo. How do you measure interest appreciation right now? You do that through the like, the media, the thumb up. And we said, no, like is meaningless. We don't like anymore. And there are a lot of reasons for that. If people chase like nowadays, you can fraction like. And we said, how do we replace it? And we come up with this quite easy concept, but it's also very revolutionary. Time. The number of seconds that your follower spends on your photo. You won't say anymore, I got 5 likes, 100 likes, 1,000 likes. You will say, I got 5 seconds, 5 minutes, 1 hour. Time is the real metric of interest regarding one visual content, regarding the photo. Here you, for example, you see the number of seconds spent in your photo, or here, for example, on your profile, you will see the number of total seconds that you got, all your followers spent in your photo. And that becomes a kind of metric of coolness. I'm cooler than you if I get more seconds. And if you translate it on a brand perspective, then we have brand also to discover which are the users, the influencers that post more interesting pictures regarding the number of followers that they have. The second characteristic of millennials is they live the moment. Okay, here it's very interesting because here we compare two different, let's say, phenomena. On the one side, the virality. How can we justify it? It's very easy. When Instagram launched Instagram Story, it was August 2016, a few months ago, almost a year ago. Instagram reached in 25 weeks, so by January 2017, 150 daily active users just on the Instagram Story. That's the number of the total Snapchat daily active user. Now we have 200 million daily active users just on the Instagram Story. That means that people want to leave the moment, carpe diem, but they want to preserve the high quality memories. On Instagram, they can save one high quality picture and also the level of the content go way higher. And at the same moment, they can post freely because they don't have the pay, say, that the content is going to be saved. How do we come up with this problem? Well, we came up on the first stage with this concept of bubble. We categorize what we call the moment, which is the photo, the single photo, according to three elements. When, where, and why the photo is being taken. These three elements basically is the power to the photo to be categorized, and we think in the future we might also introduce some kind of story, some kind of element that move more on the concept of ephemerality. And they're inclusive, they're not shy to even receive advice. One number to justify it, 250 million is the number of blogs that are right now worldwide, active or not active. People want to be influencer, people want to be influenced. So, people want to give advice, people want to receive advice, but fast, in a quick way. How do we face this issue? What we call the challenge. The challenge is a game. You take your photo, you put them together, you ask your follower base, tell me to choose. Classic customer journey. I'm a young girl that has to go out on Saturday night, I don't know what to wear, I can choose an outfit. I take the photo, I put them together, and I ask my friends, my followers, how do you choose? Vote, play with me. And this is what we call a call to participate, which is very different from the classic call to action. In a call to participate, who calls and who gives advice are on the same level, very clear. On a call to action, who calls is always one step above who gives advice, who calls. And we think that's quite bad right now. Millennial, okay, this is very, abused as a comfort, all the IRAs, and for example, Tinder. In Tinder, there are 1.4 billion swipes per day. 1.4 billion. Snapchat is going very well, so swiping is a must to have user experience of the app right now. How do we solve that? Well, we just introduce a smash swipe. We the way we call the challenge. We call the challenge that has one right and left, and all the user experience is also based on swipe. So you change moment, change photo by swiping. This is a must to have. Also, the signal right now is a huge must to have right now. Every brand, both in the fashion side and the digital side, so social media, must involve some kind of social shopping within the channels. How do we solve that? We introduce the hashtag, which is the type of the item. This is something that you might have seen on another platform. Okay, right now it is a must to have. If you don't have it, you have a yellow problem. If you have it, you're fine, but you're not over the others. The hashtag is the possibility to type the item and to give some information about the item and use it to sell it through a link that redirects straight away to the e-commerce page of that item. This is maybe the most particular concept. Okay, millennials born in a post-ideological world. They don't feel that they belong to some social group, but they feel they belong to the only biggest group worldwide, which is actually the group of millennials. Think about in the 80s, in the 70s, UPIS, in Italy, Paninari, in the 70s, IPI. All those people belong to those social circles, not just because of the pleasure of belonging to the social circle, but mainly to the fact that they want to compete against other people. Am I UP? So I'm not an UP, so I'm not a UP, and vice versa. Millennials, they belong to this big, social group because they just don't care, they want to belong to this group, they don't think about it, they're bored without these distinctions. But they want to feel unique. And the only way to feel unique is giving high level of customization at every level. What do we need is simply give the possibility to the user to register, for example, as a non-user or a professional user. You choose how to play. If you want to be an influencer, if you want to be a model, if you want to be a photographer, simply tap it. We do a double check. We do a double check as fashion. If you think you are eligible to be an influencer, a photographer, model, you would play as an influencer, photographer, or model. And especially, we give you the possibility, this might look very bad, but we give you the possibility to customize the background of every moment that you share on the other social media that you have, Instagram, Facebook, whatever. That makes your post truly unique. But, and here to come to the professor, to the B2B side. To be a true network, especially in fashion, you can't target just the consumer side. You gotta take care also of the needs of the business side. What we did is simply, before this product, before this mobile app, we launched another product, which is a dashboard that it's called Fashion for Business, which is basically a dashboard that allows business to understand the needs of millennials and allow to communicate with them in a very funny way. It's very simple, it's a concept of challenge I showed you before, but just for brands. Brands create a challenge through a dashboard, they post them on their already existing social media, so they don't have to create new follower base, to Google, Instagram, and for the first time in the history of Facebook, with one click without anyone long, your follower can vote which two followers you prefer. With that vote, the follower passes some information to hashtag, we elaborate, we analyze them, and we pass the brand to a very cool, let's say, report that the professor I don't want to bore you with the today, but for example, one of the very good information about these people is that we are the first company worldwide, I can say, that show from Facebook and from Instagram to a challenge where people accept to look at that photo. You take a picture of me like that, I can tell you you're looking at me later because you're looking at the shoes. and how many seconds we're spending on the blender, how many seconds we're spending on the shoes. And they can pass these data to brands, and so brands now know what exactly is the follower they follow the challenge and what exactly they like. This is very important for brands to understand what the lenders really like and to communicate with them in a very engaging and fun way. So I want to conclude here, and my we just want to say we're very young and we're an app. I mean, the beta is going to be launched in you'll find it, but it's going to be still a beta. We're going to be launched maybe next week maximum. But we really hope that we can be the first session network for millennials. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I think these two experiences are very complementary and very interesting to look at likes, shares, seconds, new kind of currency. And it's pretty interesting if you have time. I'd like to get you to know something more about our new currency, the field of the job, which is something that I think is super relevant also in the blonde case. So I don't know if you want to add a few things on this specific issue. And I'd like to ask you to what extent you can say, remain at the same independent when at the end you are starting to develop more and more collaboration with many different brands. So on one side you have a criteria you use to select different brands you decide to collaborate with, and now you can become a partner of some brands at the same time remain a truly independent brand, which probably is the most important asset that today customers are doing with in the digital environment.
Okay, yeah. I mean, that this is really one of the key topics in reality, probably for every, or at least should be one of the most important topics for every kind of publisher around the world. But, I mean, and it doesn't matter if you are a single blogger with 20,000 followers or like Condé Nast that you have, that you are a challenging publisher. Independency, in our world, in the actual world, is something that is really, really hard to keep from an external point of view. But in reality, it's easier than what it looks like. And why I'm saying this is, I'm saying this because slowly and probably during the past years, brand companies understood that if they want to use us, or if they want to use social media and social influencer to influence their audience, they have to understand that we are the ones setting the language. So this is already something that slowly the big companies, big players in the market are understanding. So today I had, for example, a very interesting meeting with PMG Group about brand, and they want us to invest on Chiara and on Gonzalez and trying to understand. And what we told them immediately is, okay, we have this product, we want to communicate this product to the world, we would like this product, otherwise probably we're not even sitting at the same table because we cannot communicate something that we don't like. I mean, we're not actors. That's the thing, there are no filters in social media. So we decided, then I'll say a few more words about this, but we decided to work only with comics that we like, and obviously only about products that we like. But this is not even being independent. Independent goes harder to that. And it's not picking the right brand with the right product, but really being independent is picking the right language to talk about it. So that's something that with social media, you really cannot, it's, I would say it's a clause as an economy, no? You cannot think about to communicate with other brands. There are, with another language, there are some brands that are asking you, for example, to create a picture of their product, send to them, make them, upload the picture, and then you can post it. We are not doing that, absolutely. Any kind of brand that wants to work like that with us, it's not just working with us. Because we don't want to do that. If you are coming to us, and if you want to partner with Lorenza, with Chiara, with our team, it's because you are trusting our language. Otherwise, you know, there are no opportunities to work together. If you are trusting how we communicate to the world, to our users, and how we, you know, we share the values of your product, your brand, if you don't trust them, we cannot work together. If you trust them, I mean, you have to give us, you know, open things to do that. And that's the way also for us to be the most effective possible, and obviously also for the brand to get the most that they can from our users. Also because when they come to Chiara or they come to the Lawn Salad and they want to communicate something, they're not communicating to the world, they're communicating to the Lawn Salad fan. So, I mean, the fans are used to read something, are used to get information for a certain type of language. So, if they want to talk to them, they have to speak our language. And that's absolutely something that for us is really, really important, and it has been since the beginning. Obviously, going back to the brand and the product, what we are trying also to do is to obviously to pick the right brand and the right product. I have to admit that today it's easy. When we were in the beginning, when we were in 2010, when we were in 2011, it was not so easy because we were, you know, fresh students. And I mean, when big companies were coming to us and saying, "Hey, I'm giving you 10,000 euro to post this picture," and say that that's about it, great. I mean, it was obviously not easy to say no, we don't like it. But you know, I don't know if because we were two, so Chiara and me, so we were always sharing ideas. And I don't know how to say that. We really knew that that was not the way to go further. Like, we really knew that that was not the way that would have brought us to a certain point. So that's why we decided to, you know, to keep very, very strict to our taste and to our users. So, for example, if you are a great follower of Chiara or Gonzalo, you will notice that there is no any kind of relation between us and Dolce & Gabbana, just the same way. And that's not randomly, unfortunately, but it's because, you know, we decided not to work on the product, and Stefano didn't make that so well, so we're not working with them anymore. But I mean, at a certain point, you have to decide. You cannot work with everybody. You cannot work on every kind of product. Like, I mean, you really have to pick what you like. And otherwise, it's not even that we are like heroes or something, because if you want to make business, you have to do business right. And you cannot think that you can say that everything is good, everything is cool, because today there are no filters again. Social media are made because of that. So after 6 months, the PR is saying that random products are cool, we do not have fans anymore. So, I mean, at that point, we're not making business anymore. So, you know, there's no point working like that. So, today, as I was saying, probably it's a lot easier. As today, we are, you know, like, we are approached by the coolest brands around the world, and we can choose any kind of product. So, today, it's a lot easier. And at the same time, like, we are getting probably 100 proposals a week. So, and we are just picking the top 10. Also, because we don't have enough time and resources to work on all of those, so we are always picking what is really, you know, more related to our taste, our style, and what we think our users want. Obviously, dependency is not something, I mean, there is no trick, there is no like something that is game changing. Like, or you decide to be independent, or you don't. But if you decide to be independent, trust me, you go farther in the editorial.
It's a great answer because I'm sure many people were asking, but it's really possible that sometimes you say no to some brands. Now we go to language and we are much more available than we can. And now I would like to ask you something about the kind of approach that you are following to enlarge your crowd of millennials in order to have a crowd to sell to companies. Because it's clear that you are developing a cool new approach to the life, which is no longer life, but it's the time spent on each feature. But at the same time, it's being set up for the next social network. So, what's going to make you unique is pretty clear from the technical side, but I think it's also nice to know something about the incentive that you try to push to collect more users in order to make your platform larger and larger.
Okay, that's a very, very, very difficult question to answer. I mean, every time we go to brands to try to sell our main product on the B2B side, the first question they ask is, oh, are you a social network? And I said, well, stop. Or I try to talk about something that make them confused that we're not a social network. No, we are a fashion network. However, we came up with this B2B product that it's our, you know, it's our tool that can drag the majority of users. How can we do that? This B2B product, it's exactly what brands, and especially, it's a product that both meets small medium brands, and when I say small medium brands, I'm also referring to bigger influencer that can kind of segment, and also bigger brand can use. How? Basically, by giving them, by sharing challenges on their Facebook, on their platform, they're basically creating content also on the mobile app, which is for free. They don't have to pay. They are paying for something else. They're paying for another service to get it there. So it's a completely different business model. Through that, through gaming, because gaming is very important. If you aim at building a fashion social network, any network you want right now, and you don't think about any gaming feature, trust me, it's quite difficult right now. People to stay focused on, to spend their time actually on something, they have to find funny or useful. I mean, we're not Uber, we're not Deliveroo, we don't sell food, we don't bring you anywhere. What do we do? We just, trust me, we make you spend 10 minutes of your life, I hope every day, and I hope more and more every day, in a funny way. And then we can also solve you some problem like, washing the wear, so taking fashion decision in a fast way through the challenge, and especially expressing yourself freely through cycles. This is the nice answer. Then there is the business one, which is also, yes, the real track is the B2B product. The B2B product is given to brands use them with influencer, through influencer. Every influencer, of course, is exposed to this product and this exposure bring this user. It's exactly what Instagram did back in 2012, where why did we start using Instagram? I mean, we are talking some we can talk about it later, but the first user they start using Instagram not because Instagram was cool, not because you know Riccardo and Tara were there, but because it was an app to share a picture with a nice app. That's it. Do you remember the crazy picture on Facebook on the Instagram picture share of Facebook at the beginning? Instagram. That was the tool that helped Instagram to drive users to bring into the platform. Then, of course, Instagram did a crazy job in keeping them entertained, building premium content, which is the goal of Instagram, is what makes Instagram survive. That's what we aim at doing. Through the challenge, we aim that all of you can share a challenge through our mobile app to your already existing account. And that's, for us, the way that, in a fun way, you increase the network.
Thank you very much. Just a couple of questions more, and then I would love to say some minutes to give all of you the chance to write some questions to our wonderful speakers. I just wanted to ask Riccardo few comments about the fact that you also sell your own product. So what's the vision behind the collection you develop of the capsule that you try to create a collaboration with the exclusive brands?
Okay, so just to distinguish between the Gone Salad e-commerce and Terraforming collection project. So the Gone Salad e-commerce started with a few of our big brands, big partners, like Device or this kind of brand, and we realized that we created together like limited edition product exclusively sold on the Lanza. But even for Device, this kind of project was like a big opportunity also to try to experiment something new, because like we customized like a common 501 jeans, and you know we tried something that probably they wouldn't have done on their stock product because they wouldn't have taken the risk, you know, to put on the market something that was not selling around their, you know, comfort zone or product. So for them, it's mostly a way to communicate the brand in a different way to a different target and experiment something new. But in reality, the mission of Gonzalo e-commerce is not about that. Like, it's not about working with the big established brand, but it's the way for us to work with the upcoming brands. So the thing is that obviously we cannot give for free visibility to everybody. Obviously, we very often talk about product and we discuss about brands, upcoming brands, and if the editorial team like them, if Kiara like them, they, you know, they talk about that, they post, they wear, they do, and that's absolutely free and up to anybody to, you know, do what they feel about the product, you know, about the brands. But just to have another way to give visibility to the upcoming and emerging brand, we decided to use this kind of model because for an upcoming brand, that usually it's a small company, it's kind of easy work on small amounts of product and customize them. Because, I mean, it's a lot harder to go to device and ask them to customize jeans instead of doing with the, you know, small laboratory in Veneto or whatever. So the thing is working in this way and asking them to give us the product, basically they are not investing money in getting exposure, but they are. Because we are creating product together with Chiara and together with our creative team. So basically, we are creating product that we know that we like a lot and that we share and we talk about. So in this way, the brands that are working with us are getting this product and are getting also a lot of exposure on our channels, on our Instagram, on Chiara's Instagram, and on Chiara's. And this is exactly the way that I want the e-commerce, the content e-commerce to be carried on. So in reality, it absolutely it's not conflict with our big advertisers because our advertisers are Chanel, Louis Vuitton, whatever. So I mean, they like that we are so close to the, you know, to the young project. I mean, they absolutely don't see this in any better way. And absolutely no any kind of competition. And also, according to this, in the next few months, we will also launch a few time program about that because we really want to engage more our community to create product, get exposure, and try to compete between themselves, you know, to find more exposure and from the next designers. I mean, I think that's the blog's mission in general. Like, as I always think that TPS crew is a group of talented millennials, I really want the Gonzalo to be also the window for talented millennials all over the world. So in the next month, we will carry on different projects, not only this, but, you know, about giving visibility to talents in writing, photography, design, and whatever. Talking about Chiara Ferragni collection, that's a more, you know, sensitive topic. Because in reality, we faced a few tensions about that. Like, we faced a few tensions like working with a few companies that were saying, well, we should invest on the side when Chiara is designing her own shoe collection. Obviously, this is an absolutely organic and natural question. But, and I also, it was also, in reality, we also had the opposite problem because we had like our agents, our designers, our, you know, manufacturer, the people, the whole stakeholder around the current collection that were asking, what the fuck you are working with Super? I mean, you are creating sneakers and you are, you know, advertising other kind of sneakers. In reality, I think that the balance and the independence that we were talking before, the balance between these is exactly what is bringing value to both. I mean, if Chiara from one day to the other just would wear only Chiara Ferragni collection, I mean, he would completely lose her independence and her, you know, like taste freedom. It's obviously that Chiara Ferragni collection is a great, you know, it's a great brand about sneakers, about ballerinas, about boots, whatever. But even Chiara, if she has to walk the red carpet, she probably would prefer to wear, you know, Chanel shoes or whatever. And being natural and being truly, like being truly doing that, It's what is bringing value and credibility also when she wear the sneakers of her current collection. Because if she would wear, you know, just that product, it would be completely, level on that. And on the, like, slowly keeping on this kind of balance also, you know, made also our advertisement understand that Chiara was not absolutely wearing only shoes, probably not advertising in general, we don't sell only our shoes, but we were even trying to give visibility even more to the other shoes. Because if on the one side I put a gallery of, you know, like we are, I don't know, talking about the best sneakers of the season, and we put, we post like 10 pictures of the best sneakers of the season, if I put 10 pictures of like from the collection shoes, no one would care about that, no? But if I put Balenciaga, Gucci, Chanel, Chiara collection, Prada, and Superga, because we like that and we think that Superga is super iconic and we want to do that, every single of those pictures will get real focus, will get real attention, and will be really credible in being that. So, I mean, it's all a matter of, you know, being independent, being free, and have a balance with.
Thank you so much. Very quickly, you are also basically in the condition to collect a number of inputs about what are the kind of products that users actually then essentially like. To what extent do you think that companies are really ready to listen? You talk about sentiment analysis, the opportunity to rely on customer engagement. In your experience, to what extent companies are really willing to listen to what you can tell them from the customer side?
Okay, could you give me an example about that? It's not the right place. Otherwise, I'll go a bit long. But the problem is when brands right now receive a crazy huge amount of data from everywhere. The biggest goal for brands is to select and collect the correct data, the one that they really need, and to deliver, to put the data together, to format information, to deliver this information to the right person in the company that has to take the decision. In my experience, brands pretend, not everyone, but brands in average pretend to approach the digital revolution right now just by making 20 millennials among this folk. They put them in the company and they say, oh, especially in the social media, digital side, and the department, and they say, we are digital, we're cool. No, it doesn't work like that. Brands have to embrace digital revolution at every level of the value chain. Digital doesn't mean just social media, digital means everything, means production, means merchandising, means communication, means marketing, and at the end, means social media, which is a vehicle to deliver some message. In my experience, brands have just to embrace this kind of digital revolution to be really able to answer the question that the millennial target user base is asking right now.
Thank you very much. For the sake of time, I'd like to stop my questions. I have a lot of many more things, but I think it's very valuable if we have the chance to collect the questions on your own side. So, is there anyone who wants to take the chance to take the ice and rise? Try to see if you can speak loudly.
Hi everyone, first thanks for the presentation. From the point of view, someone who wants to launch a brand, so what are the risks of going through bloggers and influencers? As first, yeah, it seems that it's cheaper, but I guess there are also some risks and you lose control over your brand, so what do you think of this question?
It's a really good question. As I was, telling you like earlier, when we were talking about the independence, also of a blogger, from the other point of view, from the brand point of view, it's really, really important to do the right scouting about, what's your product, what's your brand, what the values that you want MBA. Because I today mainly, and probably I shouldn't say this because of Chiara's audience, but I don't believe anymore in numbers. I believe in quality. What is it about how many influencers, like global bloggers, like 250 million worldwide? And I mean, and there are like how many bloggers today, how many influencers that has millions and millions of followers on their social media channel. So I mean that today, and I really think that today is really important and crucial for brands that want to use social influencer to deliver their message to the world, to select the people they want. And because they cannot just lose control on their product and also on their messages. And if they lose control in front of millions of people, that's a huge mess. So the thing that you like, it's really, really important is to pick the right one, like do the right scout and try to understand who is the best in delivering your message. Obviously, if you ask me how can I do that, it's not easy. I mean, obviously, that's not a quantity analysis, that's a quality analysis. You have to understand. Starting with a few of our big brands, big partners, like Device or this kind of brand, and we realized that we created together like limited edition product exclusively sold on the website. But even for Device, this kind of project was like a big opportunity also to try to experiment. New. Because like we customize like a common 501 jeans, and we tried something that probably they wouldn't have done from their stock product because they wouldn't have taken the risk to put on the market something that was not selling around their comfort zone of the product. So for them it's mostly a way to communicate the brand in a different way to different target and experiment something new. But in reality, the mission of Gonzaga e-commerce is not about that. Like, it's not about working with the big established brand, but it's the way for us to work with the upcoming brands. So the thing is that obviously we cannot give for free visibility to everybody. Obviously, we very often talk about product and we discuss about brands, upcoming brands. And if the editorial team like them, if Chiara like them, they they talk about that, they post, they wear, they do, and that's absolutely free and up to anybody to do what they feel about the product, about the brands. But just to have another way to give visibility to the upcoming and emerging brand, we decided to use this kind of model because for an upcoming brand, that usually it's a small company. It's kind of easy work on small amounts of product and customize them. Because, it's a lot harder to go to Device and ask them to customize jeans instead of doing with the small laboratory in Veneto or whatever. So the thing is working in this way and asking them to give us the product. Basically, they are not investing money in getting exposure, but they are. Because we are creating product together with Chiara and together with our creative team. So basically, we are creating product that we know that we like a lot and that we share and we talk about. So in this way, the brands that are working with us are getting this product and are getting also a lot of exposure on our channels, on our Instagram, on Chiara's Instagram, and on Chiara's. And this is exactly the way that I want the e-commerce, the content e-commerce to be carried on. So in reality, it's not conflict with our big advertisers because our advertisers are Chanel, Louis Vuitton, whatever. So they like that we are so close to the to the young project. They absolutely don't see this in any better way. And absolutely no any kind of competition. And also according to this, in the next few months we will also launch a few time program about that because we really want to engage more our community to create product, get exposure, and try to compete between themselves, to find more exposure and from the next designers. I think that's the blog's mission in general. As I always think that TPS crew is a group of talented millennials, I really want the Gonzaga to be also the window for our talented millennials all over the world. So in the next month, we will carry on different projects, not only this, about, you know, about giving visibility to talents in writing, photography, design, and whatever. Talking about curation and collection, that's a more, you know, sensitive topic, because in reality, we faced a few tensions about that. Like in the, we faced a few tensions like working with a few companies that were saying, well, we should invest on the side when Chiara is designing her own shoe collection. Obviously, this is an absolutely organic and natural question. But, and I also, it was also, in reality, we also had the opposite problem, because we had like our agents, our designers, our, you know, manufacturer, the people, the whole stakeholder around Carolina Collection that were asking, what the fuck you are working with Super? I mean, we are creating sneakers and you are, you know, advertising other kind of sneakers. In reality, I think that the balance and the independence that we were talking before, the balance between these is exactly what is bringing value to both. I mean, if Chiara from day to the other just would wear only Chiara for the collection, I mean, he would completely lose her independence and her, you know, like his freedom. It's obviously that Chiara for the collection is a great, you know, it's a great brand about sneakers, about ballerinas, about boots, whatever. But even Chiara, if she has to walk the red carpet, she probably would prefer to wear, you know, Chanel shoes or whatever. And being natural and being truly doing that is what is bringing value and credibility also when she wear the sneakers of her current collection. Because if she would wear, you know, just that product, it would be completely, whatever on that. And on the, like, slowly keeping on this kind of balance also, you know, made also our advertisement understand that Chiara was not absolutely wearing only shoes, probably not advertising in general on the one side, only our shoes, but we were even trying to give visibility even more to the other shoes. Because if on the one side I put a gallery of, you know, like we are, I don't know, talking about the best sneakers of the season, and we put, we post like 10 pictures of the best sneakers of the season, if I put 10 pictures of Chiara for the collection shoes, no one would care about that, no? But if I put Balenciaga, Gucci, Chanel, Chiara for the collection, Prada, and Superga, because we like that and we think that Superga is super iconic and we want to put that, every single of those pictures will get real focus, will get real attention, and will be really credible in being that. So, I mean, it's all a matter of, you know, being independent, being free, and have a balance with.
Thank you so much. Very quickly, Mauro, you are also basically in the condition to collect a number of inputs about what are the kind of products that users actually then essentially like. To what extent do you think that companies are really ready to listen? You talk a lot about sentiment analysis, the opportunity to rely on customer engagement. In your experience, to what extent companies are really willing to listen to what you can tell them from the customer side?
Okay, could you give me an example about that? It's not the right place. Otherwise, I'll go a bit long. But the problem is when brands right now receive a crazy huge amount of data from everywhere. The biggest goal for brands is to select and collect the correct data, the one that they really need, and to deliver, to put the data together, to form information, to deliver this information to the right person in the company that has to take the decision. In my experience, brands prepend, not everyone, but brands in average prepend to approach a digital revolution right now just by taking 20 millennials on this call. They could meet the company and they say, oh, especially in the social media, digital side, and the department, and they say, we're digital, we're cool. No, it doesn't work like that. Brands have to embrace digital revolution at every level of the value chain. Digital doesn't mean just social media, digital means everything, means production, means merchandising, means communication, means marketing, and at the end, means social media, which is a vehicle to deliver some message. In my experience, brands have just to embrace this kind of digital revolution to be really able to answer the question that, the millennial target user base is asking right now.
Thank you very much. For the sake of time, I'd like to stop my questions. I have a lot of many more things, but I think it's very valuable if we have the chance to collect the questions on your own side. So, is there anyone who wants to take the chance to take the ice and rise? Try to see if you can speak loudly.
Hi everyone, first thanks for the presentation. From the point of view, someone who wants to launch a brand, so what are the risks of going through bloggers and influencers? As first, yeah, it seems that it's cheaper, but I guess there are also some risks and you lose control over your brand. So what do you think of this question?
I mean, it's a really good question. As I was, you know, telling you like earlier, when we were talking about the independence, also of a blogger, from the other point of view, from the brand point of view, it's really, really important to do the right scouting about, you know, what's your product, what's your brand, what the values that you want to communicate. Because I today, mainly, and probably I shouldn't say this because of Chiara's audience, but I don't believe anymore in numbers. I believe in quality. What is it about how many influencers, like bloggers, like 250 million worldwide? And I mean, and there are like how many bloggers today, how many influencers that has millions and millions of followers on their social media channel? So, I mean, that today, and I really think that today, is really important and crucial for brands that want to use such an influencer to you know, deliver their message to the world, to select it, to pick the right one. And because they cannot, you know, just lose control on their product and also on their messages. And if they lose control in front of millions of people, that's a huge mess. So the thing that you like, it's really, really important is to pick the right one, like do the right scout and try to understand who is the best in delivering your message. Obviously, if you ask me how can I do that, it's not easy. I mean, obviously, that's not a quantity analysis, that's a quality analysis. You have to understand what kind of you know, editorial strategy that kind of influencer has, which is the engagement, how are the comments, how many likes, how maybe you can use also question to understand how long. You know, their users are spending on the picture, or in general, I mean, you really have to try to understand which is the quality of the engagement of the fan base around the influencer, instead of just saying, oh, okay, Charles has 9 million users, so I'm gonna go over. I mean, obviously, that's important, that's interesting. They were going to work, you know, proper example again, and they were saying, okay, we want mass, that needs to go to mass for sure. That's one of the needs for many companies and many products and many brands. But if you like this is already a topic like really important. Like it is also it really also really important to understand which is your target, which is your, you know, aim. You wanna get big amount of people, you wanna get the right one, which is like first question is which is your product. So it is luxury car or it is a hair product. So starting from that, there's, you know, many kind of analysis that you can do about the engagement, the positioning, and the quality of the editorial process that an influencer is doing, and according to that you can pick the right one. But really, trust me, and again, I'm probably saying this against my interest, but could convert way better 100,000 followers that are really interested in what we're communicating instead of 9 million that are not. So that's the way, you know, to be about it.
Yeah. You want to try to speak loudly?
Okay, it's not loud enough. Okay.
Linking also to other questions. Don't you think that social media has influencing the value good markets? I mean, right now, I think it's booming more than ever, like brands like Vuitton or Supreme, Yeezy, that basically are streetwear brands, but it's selling 1,000 times more expensive than normal brand. Which is the social media role in this?
Okay, so I mean, I think that the social media in reality has not like a main role in this. I just think that in general, like, this is the phase of street style, this is the phase of activewear, this is the phase of that kind of styling products. Like, as Otto was saying, like, I don't think that social media necessarily or digital necessarily has an important role in everything is done. I mean, that's one part of the revolution. Probably it's playing like a very important role in a few changes, but that's not the only thing that is changing. Like, also the way people and millennials and in general, you know, buyers are consuming fashion and goods all around the world is changing. It's changing the way they buy, it's changing what they want, but just because, you know, the people are evolving during the phases, during the ages, during the years, they are evolving, they are evolving. So talking about this, I really, you know, I don't think that social media are deciding the style, the trends, the fashion, but obviously social media are making everybody of us a media, okay? Everybody of us is a media thanks to Instagram. Like, if you think about that, obviously social media are helping this kind of company create hype and mass around the world. For sure, these are those kind of companies that probably wouldn't have the same media or advertising power that other kind of company could have. So for sure, social media that usually are like more affordable media and advertising channels are helping those kind of companies in new getting to market faster and easier instead of big companies. But so basically, it is still part of the democratization phenomena of social media, but it's basically just helping emerging still and upcoming companies communicate to the world, but it's for sure not affecting the style. I mean, obviously, if you're scouting around the web or if you check the street style, you get influences and you get to find trends. But the big trends going on in the fashion industry are, I mean, I think that are the result of the like 50-year evolution of the, the costume, so it's
a bit different. I think we have just one thing on this point, because I agree with you when you say that, of course, it's an evolution. It can't be just thanks to social media. However, I think it's the first time in history that somewhere in fashion companies, design are not just dictated top-down by designers, which they still have huge power. But it's the first time that it's social media help to build styles bottom up. I see someone where I see that guy wearing a very cool scarf but then a very cool t-shirt. If I like it and I share it, if another person not like it and share it, it could create a trend. Then it's gonna be the brand, the designer, to I don't wanna say copy, but to adopt that style to maybe to change it. Of course, to customize it and then to sell it at the style. So I think it's the first time that style comes bottom
up. Absolutely, I agree completely with you about this. But again, I don't think that this is like I think that this is like a marginal, small part of what's going on. And I don't think that the arriving, to the outer world, sportswear as a big fashion is because of that, but probably it's empowered by it's for sure empowered by social media phenomena. I don't think that
it's easy to justify the role of the designers, the brands,
but then it's getting
less than 1 year ago that dogs might not have a new design in the next season, so let's wait.
I'm a big supporter of the customer engagement phenomenon, as many of you know, but I think that still, that is, especially the luxury segment, subject to clearly distinguish. There was another question.
Thank you. The first thing, I want to understand two things, actually. The first thing is that all this applies to a certain product category. So it's about this fashion, it's apparel. But you also branch out, you guys also branch out on lifestyle. Lifestyle is also one of the categories that goes above, so for example, a car. So I want to understand, with the affordability of the cars or such products that go down and get democratized, is that something, is that a next step to branch out? So is this, are those tools something that are proving the concept of fashion? And then can be branched out to other industries, can be branched out to other product categories? Or is that something that is strictly applicable to fashion? Is that clear or?
Yeah, it is completely. That's absolutely a smart question. I mean, for sure, fashion is the most dynamic industry, but that's usually the industry that is. Let's say it's receiving and getting the input from the market, from communication, faster than any other industry. At least I'm also testing that every day because fashion companies started calling me like 7-8 years ago. Like, cars industry are coming now, design industry probably will get in years. And I mean, so for sure, industry are, you know, facing and approaching this kind of new communication tools in a different phase. But absolutely, like, I can tell you that all these kind of tools for this kind of communication codes that are changing are absolutely applicable to any other industry. If you think about cars, for example, today, like, if you have the possibility to have somebody living an experience inside that car and bring that car around and like doing a story, like some stories inside the car, like driving, whatever. Like, I don't really see any kind of limitation about that, but it's just another way to communicate something and make something, even more appealable and even more like attractive for the users. For sure, we are not talking anymore about performance. That is something that, I mean, but in general, any car that we buy tomorrow will probably last for the next 20 years and whatever. Like, we are not buying cars anymore because they go faster or, I mean, yes, but obviously if you're passionate about running, whatever, you want to buy a Porsche 991, whatever, for sure. But in general, like, you're buying a car because attached to that car, there are key values that are characterizing and you are like feeling part of those kind of values. So if you find the right influencer, the right channel to communicate those values, for sure you know that you are empowering the attractiveness of that car.
And you wouldn't consider it a sellout. Like, is that, for example, like a car is very difficult to convert. Like, such activities in the media, like I speaking from experience, in company I work for, trying to pitch a social media strategy, trying to pitch actual communication campaign that does not go that does not go goes on the normal channels, have been data and proven and all that, it's very difficult. It's very difficult to prove the impact on the baseline because at the end of the day, the only thing they're going to see is that story is being posted in 1 month time, how many more cars, how many more financing do we sell on that specific car. And if Delta is positive, we invest again, otherwise it's parking. So that then so and that's very specific. Like Chiara goes or Blanzala or any fashion time, there's a story about a Fiat 500 or an Alfa Romeo or an Audi. I mean that's very different. Is that going to stick for that car?
I understood the beginning of the question, and it was mostly about, you know, the conversation, right? Like the conversion.
Yeah.
I mean, that for sure is something that it's really hard, really, really hard to evaluate and analyze. But I think that the brand today, as again, we're like cars, brands are not selling machines anymore, but they are selling values, they are selling something that somebody should be feeling part of. I mean, so what I want to say is that if you take this as a concept, as an assumption, like you need somebody to communicate that and to educate that, like even younger to future, you know, future buying or whatever. Like, I mean, if you're working with, if you're working for Maserati and you are communicating from Chiara audience, obviously the core of Chiara's audience is around 25, 26 years old, and Maserati is not related to that target today. But you cannot know, like, if you start communicating Maserati to that target today, probably they buy Maserati when they were before you. So, I mean, I also think that you, like, but this is very common between all luxury brands, and not only cars or fashion, even in fashion. Like, social media is also a great tool to educate the, you know, the audience.
Thank you very much. It's pretty late, I think we have time for a very last question. If there was two very last questions, really quickly.
Can I ask you, Deborah, can I take a staff here before we go at the end of the conversation?
Actually, there are many of them. So, as a guy, I'll be quick. The question is more for looking. So, you mentioned about how you want to build a media community or a media company. And you also mentioned about the wall and how they are not able to communicate effectively with young people. However, they are still creating very relevant and important content. So do you see in future, for example, a blogging community and editorial community that now seems like they're creating titles to be more linked and merged together, and maybe companies like WWE partnering with you and creating sort of a powerhouse? Like a powerhouse media where the
high-level
editorial content is linked
with
high-level blogging
content. Yeah, I mean, I can see that. Again, I think that in general, borders between contents, countries, digital, non-digital, or whatever, are like, it's like a model concept. So even in this way, like thinking that like an established high-quality content publisher, he finds a way to match with the blogging world, with the blogging like company. I think that it could become even more effectively the like the high-quality content. For sure, the audience are not typically the same. For sure, the audience could be, you know, be different from, you know, for different clusters of interest or whatever. But the thing is that today, as we were saying also before, like millennials in general are, I think that are very educated and complicated in certain ways, even complex people. Because we're not trying to cluster us as I am in 1986 kind of thing. We're not clustering us anymore in specific. So probably in a certain moment of my day, I'm interested in that blogging content, and maybe in another moment of my day, I'm interested in high quality content from WWD or business professional or whatever. And maybe in another moment of my day, I'm interested in a, you know, TV series on Netflix or whatever. So I really think that we are a generation, and the millennials don't see the generation, and probably it's a generation that still going to figure it out. Those are a generation that people have many interests, many kind of languages, many kind of code that they are allowed with. So that's really yes. Like I can see like the merge of this kind of world if they find the right way and, you know, the right also the right timing to do things. Because obviously the only thing is that having a strong brand identity is really important. So the thing is that if I want blogging, I know that I want. But the moment that I want high quality, I know if I go on WWD, I can find it. But if then I have only one platform and I cannot exactly understand what I'm getting when, that could be a problem. So, like, confusion is a big problem, but for sure, I mean, if you manage to do that and having just, you know, one media brand that is giving you a like, full offer, could be interesting. I mean, there could be many risks about that because of confusion, because of not strong brand identity enough, but I mean, could be, could be.
Do you have any remarks
on the issue? Just what Riccardo was saying, for example, we decide to categorize the kind of view on our app. You decide how to play, so we distinguish precisely if you are an influencer, if you are a magazine, or if you are a normal user. So I agree completely with Riccardo. If you can just find a media links where website that can help you to categorize and filter content in an easy, fun, and quick way, I think that would be a first solution.
I mean, we are over time. If you have an additional question, two second question and one second answer.
Last year, our fashion blogger in Australia came out with this very dramatic video in which she was complaining about the whole industry, that it was fake, and it had got a very huge momentum on the internet. So my question for both of you was, how much do you see that as a threat of millennials becoming a little bit disillusioned with this whole world of sparkling influencers? And very quick answer is fine.
I wish we could be very fast, but I think that the answer is going to be very fast. Yeah. In general, I remember the fact, and I mean, I can see why it happened. For sure, like the blogger industry, the influencer industry is something that should be regulated a lot more. And not only by like law regulation or whatever, but we probably, I mean, it's new, it's completely new, so we know that any time in the history that something like the new industry, horizon, many cases there is a revolution, or you discover something, in the beginning there is an anarchy, no? It's normal, because there are no regulations, there is no anarchy about that. So not even, again, though, but really anarchy in using the tool and using the channel. I think that slowly, this kind of phenomenon will be regulated, but not because of the laws, but will be regulated because of the moral feelings and things about the users in this channel. So probably slowly we get to a better level. And okay.
Well, almost same answer in the sense that it's gonna auto-regulate itself by users filtering and selecting the best content that they like. If I see a fashion blogger with whatever meaning users that one day says I like red, and the other day casually says I hate red, sorry, the day after she says I like red, but it's painful. Maybe that might raise some questions out. So, but I think millennials especially are quite smart in playing used to that. They can recognize what something is natural or when something is not.
Thank you so much.
Student profession for the evening, and please stop 1 second because I know it's important to set the world today. So, let's see, just 1 second more. Give Paolo and Riccardo the chance to take a second.
I think
if you want to stand up, and maybe just the first row, move a bit backward, would be easier because you are so
many. I can take a picture.
So you are really too many, so maybe you can just move a bit backward would be better because I can fit more. Otherwise, like this, I could never the room.
Okay.
No, this is my father.
By the cheese.